Aloha mai kākou. Aloha kakahiaka. Good morning and welcome to all. If you are joining us here for the first time, I promise I won't embarrass you, but I just want to get to take a couple minutes after this service. You can be with myself. My name is Kane. I am an alakai here, or an elder. This is Brother Tim. He's our leading, he's our leading pastor. And that's Brother Ian in the corner. If not, you can talk to anybody else that you see behind there on the tech team. We just like aloha you and thank you so much for coming. If you are joining us live, please feel free to share the link. As we say every week, the most important thing for us is the Word of God. Amen. So I want to encourage you this morning with a scripture that comes from 1 Chronicles 29:11. And I pray that whatever you're going through right now, that you will just put that aside, lay that before God. And I pray that the intention is to build an intimate relationship with God. And let not whatever you're going through be a distraction to hearing the word. Once again, 1 Chronicles 29:11 says, "Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all." Will you please stand with me as we worship, as we praise our King Jesus. Aloha, have a blessed service.
Good morning, Ohanas. Let's give King Jesus some praise.
Deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. fail. He will never 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 fail. Build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up, it's your church. Build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up, we're your church. Build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up, it's your church. Build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up, we're your church. Build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up, it's your church. Build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. Upon this rock you build your church, in the gate of hell will not prevail. When we bind and loose, we proclaim your truth, and in Jesus' name we'll never fail. Upon this rock you build your church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. When we bind and loose, we proclaim your truth, and in Jesus' name we'll never fail. He will 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 never fail. Upon this rock you build your church, in the gate
saints.
When we bind and loose, we proclaim your truth, and in Jesus' name we'll never fail. Upon this rock you build your church, in the gates of hell will not prevail. When we bind and loose, we proclaim your truth, and in Jesus' name we'll never fail. We'll never fail.
Morning. I want to share from you from Matthew 6, verse 19. It says, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal." Verse 21 finishes, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." One of my favorite passages for sure, and I think just a appropriate truth to point us in this time of generosity, as we've talked about hopefully every week, And it's not about the dollar amount that goes into the bowl, because God is far greater than any dollar. If he needs a penny or he needs a million, he can get them any which way that, he created everything. It's not about what you can or can't put in there or how much you write that check for. It's about your heart. And that's one of my favorite passages. Really gives you an opportunity to evaluate where your treasure is, because there your heart is also. So maybe this is just a time for you to evaluate yourself, to remind yourself, and then especially in the context of the finances, is in this time of our generosity. So let's just pray, and then I'll remind you how we give here to Ohana Church, and we can continue worshiping. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you that you are so far greater than any financial issues we might having, so far greater than any amount that we can or cannot put into the offering bowl. But Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to demonstrate our dependence on you, to demonstrate our faith, our trust, our love to you in one of the areas that is so critical for us as human beings is our finances. God, we give to you not even a portion of what you gave for us. It's not even comparable, Lord, but we give to you for you, Lord. Take this money that comes into Ohana Church. May it go through Ohana Church for the purposes of you and the furthering of your kingdom, for the gospel to be preached here in Hilo, on the Big Island, Hawaii State, and across the world. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to come together in fellowship and praise. Lord, we just thank you for what you have done for us from creation to the cross to forever. Praise your name. Amen. So just as a reminder, you can give in the bowl in the back. You can go onto our website at ohanachurch.com, and you can text the amount to 84321. Let's go ahead and stand and continue worshiping.
Oh,
You may be seated. Please take a look at the screen.
It's meant to be opened, explored, pursued. It's made to be read, reread, applied, and used. The sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, with wisdom, life-changing, to lead us on. It's made for guidance, to teach us His ways, showing what's true, right, and worthy of praise. It's meant to be hidden, deep in our hearts, daily examined as the morning starts. No greater glimpse of God do we have, a lamp to our feet and a light to our path.
Good morning. I must admit, the most nerve-wracking time is this transition for me. Just getting up here, getting everything set up, and then the light goes poof. But it's good to be with you guys this morning. Thank you for the melody, for the worship, and continue on in worshiping God in our study of Him. And as we do, if you are able, please stand as we read scripture. This morning, our scripture reading is found in Genesis chapter 28, starting in verse 10. Now Jacob went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. So he came to a certain place and stayed there all night because the sun had set. And he took one of the stones of that place and put it at his head, and he lay down in that place to sleep. Then he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and its top reached to heaven. And there the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and your descendants. Also, your descendants shall be as the dust of the earth. You shall spread abroad to the west and the east, to the north and the south. And in you and in your seed, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. Then Jacob rose early in the morning, took the stone that he had put at his head, set it up as a pillar, and poured oil on top of it. And he came and he called the name of that place Bethel. But the name of that city had been Luz previously. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, if God will be with me and keep me in this way that I am going, and give me bread to eat and clothing to put on, so that I come back to my father's house in peace, then the Lord shall be my God. And this stone which I have set as a pillar shall be God's house, and of all that you give me, I will surely give a tenth to you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning. Thank you for the choice of worship that puts what you have done for us into perspective. That all we have to offer you is our lives. To make your name great, to worship you, to glorify you in all we say and do. And I pray, Lord, this morning that you
will be the faithful one as we read. That the Holy Spirit would help us this morning. Help us to see your goodness. Help us to see that without your marvelous hand, without your beautiful face, that everything is undone, everything is finished. I pray, Lord, for your glory in your word as we look at it this morning. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may have a seat. Our outline this morning, we'll start off with the just understanding the patriarchal blessing. Then we'll move on to Jacob. And then Jacob again, when his name is turned into Israel. This is week 5, I believe. But I just want to, like I always do, go back to, I think it was week 2 or 3. And it was the seed. And the emphasis, again, as we move forward, this is what I'm hoping, is that we would just anchor down in the seed, the thought of that coming Messiah that would bless all families. And it's going to get hard as we move forward, I just want you to pivot off of that, the seed. Continue our study. And in my study, in my life, that has been very instrumental in understanding the scriptures. Some people approach the scriptures and they look for principles to apply to their life. That's in there, but that's not the efficient. From the very beginning, seeing what God has done, seeing Genesis 3:15 and the promise, and then seeing it lived out in all of Scripture, even to the New Testament, where they start off with a genealogy about the seed. So if you, that's why I really stuck on that. And it will, for me, it opened my eyes to the rest of Scripture. And how relatable it is to who God is and his plan of redemption. But this week it's looking at down the line with the seed. First point is the patriarchal blessing. And what that is, we see in Scripture, we see it a lot. A lot of, deathbed, so to speak, talks. Where the patriarch, the male head of the family, he blesses the next leader, which is normally the firstborn. Normally. So he blesses the next leader of the family. It's a combination of benediction and prediction. The benediction is a pronouncement of God's favor upon a person. And then also added is a prediction, a summary of what was to come in the person's life. You know, you might think, oh, it's like how my inheritance goes or the will of my family, my parents. Yes and no. There is that part of it as well. But the prediction part, when you read it in Scripture, it's pretty interesting. It's pretty amazing when you see it. You see how this is prophetic almost to the T as Scripture, continues on. So it's God's on the next leader, and it's also a prediction of what is to come in that person's life. Yesterday, I made a prediction for my children. Well, I've been predicting it for a long time. My daughter, she always says, oh, I just want to stay home. They're at the time like, oh, what do you want to do for college? Where do you want to go? My daughter says, I just want to stay home. So I said, okay, here's the patriarchal blessing here. The prediction is you'll be a farmer, and you can stay home and just go out, farm, come back in when you want. Plus, you'll be a realtor. Oh. Any realtors in the house? Oh, soon? Yeah? And then I've been predicting my son, for a couple of years now, says, you'll be a CPA. Oof, so big shoes, big prediction. So you guys can come alongside me and help me make that happen. But in similar ways, that's what we see in Scripture. And also the birthright, it's the birthright of the firstborn. So this blessing is a benediction, prediction, goes to the firstborn normally. And in summary, it's an authority figure being passed down, and it may include specific aspects of an inheritance. And the last thing is, again, I already said it, but it's the seed. Right? In the context of the Scripture, Genesis 3:15 is part of the history of Abraham's descendants. Right? This knowledge of the seed that would come, that was part of this blessing. That you would be the line, you would be the seed that will continue, you would be the descendant that the light shines upon, expecting the seed to come from. So it's bigger than just inheritance. It was about who would be the line that would bless all families. Genesis 4:26 says, the men began to call on the name of the Lord. Or in other translations, it says, men began to worship God. Right? In context, again, Genesis 4, that's not fitting. It's kind of just tacked on there. But if you think about what was promised, now the men, now the women, now all human beings have something to worship God about as God gives Adam and Eve seed and continues seed and seed. And now they worship God. Because of his word. This was a big thing. Second point of this morning is we'll look at Jacob. And I know we took a big jump, but last week we looked at the covenant, the promise. The promised child Isaac came, and his story wasn't, you know, exciting. No, so I just jumped it. No, I'm just kidding. But for time's sake, right, a couple weeks I said, read the story, because we're going to make big jumps here. Because even next week, we're going to jump to Joseph. So it's big jumps. But Abraham and Sarah, they get their promised seed. It's not Ishmael, it's Isaac. And in Genesis 25, Isaac marries Rebecca. Oh, gotta try to keep them straight. Isaac marries Rebecca, and in Genesis 25, God speaks to Rebecca and tells her, you have twins. You have two nations in the womb. And he says, he tells Rebecca, will serve the younger. So in Genesis 25, Rebecca has her boys. Esau comes out. And the Bible tells us he's red and hairy. So they name him Esau, which means red. And while Esau comes out, the other twin, the twin Jacob, comes out and he's holding on to the heel of his older brother. And that image is how Jacob gets his name. Right? That hanging onto the heel is not cute. It's not, oh look, the babies are playing. They see that and they say, okay, Jacob is a supplanter, the name, the word, the Bible, when you break it down. Or it could be said as this, cause one to stumble. Right? It wasn't a brothers holding hands while they're coming out of the womb. They translated it as Jacob is holding on to his brother for some reason, and not in a good way, but to stumble, for his brother to stumble. The word supplanter is defined as causes one to stumble. Let me try something here. I'm going to throw out this term. You ever heard of ankle pick? Anybody hear of ankle pick in here? It's not a farming tool. It's a wrestling term. And it's not the professional wrestling with, you know, The Rock and all that, but it's the other wrestling. I don't know. I don't even know what you call it, regular wrestling. But it's an ankle pick. If you can picture, they lock up, and the point of the ankle pick is, you guys envision it? They go down, and what are they doing? They're grabbing their leg. They're grabbing the ankle. What's the purpose? Trip them, flip them, stumble. That's what Jacob was doing. So the ankle pick, wrestling, to trip up, it caused someone to stumble. Later on in Genesis 25, Esau comes back from a hunting expedition and he's hungry. And as by right, Esau was the first one to be born, he has that birthright over Jacob. But he comes up hungry. I guess the hunting wasn't good that day. And there you have Jacob stirring some stew. Maybe it was pho. Getting ready some pho, the noodles. Whatever the case be, Esau said, give me a bowl. And Jacob says, give me your birthright. Even trade. And Esau says, what does it matter? I'm about to die of hunger. A little dramatic. But that's how guys get. So he ends up selling his birthright. They make an oath. And Jacob is now in line to receive the blessing between Esau and Jacob anyway. In Genesis 27, in the beginning, we see the second part that needs to happen. Between Jacob and Esau, they made an oath. Jacob's going to get the birthright, but his dad doesn't know that. So in the beginning of Genesis 27, we see mom come into the picture. And if you ask the question, who is the mama's boy? You know who it was. It was Jacob. And she even told Jacob, don't worry about anything. Let your curse be on me. And they lie. They plan, premeditated everything to steal the blessing from Father Isaac. She tells him, Go get the goats. I'll make the soup. Then she went ahead and got clothing from Esau's closet. And even the hairy part, they put the skins of the goat all over Jacob. And the text tells us he's there, and Isaac is not fully on board. He says, "Are you sure you're my son, Esau?" And Jacob has to play along. "Yes, I am." And he even uses God's name in vain. And even when the food is ready in fast food, first fast food of the Bible, is there. Isaac asked him, how did you come back so fast? And Jacob uses God's name in vain. He says, "The Lord gave it to me." It's nothing but lying and deceit. And in Genesis 27, verse 26, we read here, it says, "Then his father Isaac said to him," this is to Jacob, "Come near now and kiss me, my son." And he came near and kissed him, and he smelled the smell of his clothing and blessed him and said, "Surely the smell of my son is like the smell of a field, which the Lord has blessed. Therefore may God give you of the dew of heaven, of the fatness of the earth, and plenty of grain and wine. Let people serve you, nations bow down to you. Be master over your brethren, and let your mother's sons bow down to you. Cursed be everyone who curses you, and blessed be those who bless you." So there in Genesis 27, Jacob receives the second part of the patriarchal blessing. Stole the birthright, and now he stole that blessing, that benediction from his dad, that prediction from his dad, that he would be blessed. Just a second later, Esau steps into the scene, and Esau is not happy about it. Verse 36, and Esau said, "Is he not rightly named Jacob? For he has supplanted me these two times. He took away my birthright, and now look, he has taken away my blessing." He's not happy. Verse 41, he says, "So Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing with which his father blessed him. And Esau said in his heart, 'The days of mourning for my father are at hand. Then I will kill my brother Jacob.'" Basically, he's saying, "Okay, when my father dies, that's when I will avenge the wrongs that was done to me." He's not happy. Mother Rebecca hears that. Again, looking out for her son, and sends him away for a few days. It was supposed to be a few days, but it ended up to be 20 years. And on that way, we read it in our scripture reading in Genesis 28. God meets Jacob. Well, in a dream, he gives Jacob a vision. Gives Jacob a vision, and he sees a ladder from heaven to earth. And the angels, God's angels going up and down. And that explanation of that was that the ladder was a picture of God's dealings with his creation. That God is doing something all the time. Right? And God was giving Jacob a bigger picture. A bigger picture of the world, a bigger picture of what's going on. And especially a bigger picture of Jacob's involvement in this whole situation. Let me read Genesis 28, verse 13. It says, "And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and your descendants. Also your descendants shall be as the dust of the earth. You shall spread abroad to the west and to the east, to the north and the south. And in you and in your seed, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you." So Jacob here, he goes, he's sent away to his uncle. And in the process, he is to find a wife. And Rebecca, his mom's hopes was that Esau, her other son, would forget the whole thing. He would calm down. And that they could have Thanksgiving dinner like normal. But that doesn't happen. 20 years go by. He wrestles. I like that word. He wrestles with Uncle Laban. You guys understand? Remember the story? He goes and he sets eye at the woman at the well. And he's like, okay, this is the wife. But he goes to see Uncle / father-in-law. And Laban does what Jacob does. He supplants Jacob. And he does the role switcheroo, and he puts his other daughter in the mix. And now Jacob has to stay, because that's not the daughter that he wanted. So he stays another 7 years. Then he finally gets the daughter, and then Laban just drags his feet until it's 20 years, and Jacob is bursting at the seams with livestock, with his own household, servants. And he said, okay. And he looks back 20 years ago of this instance when he's at Bethel, and he says, this is what God promised me. Verse 15 again, let me read it. It says, "Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you." That's the promise. That's in Jacob's head. Jacob's head is this, okay, I got to go back to my homeland. I got to go back to where I'm from. And 20 years is too long. And in Genesis chapter 32, 20 years from that point, we see Jacob finally coming home. On his way home, he hears of his brother. And in the path that they're headed, they will meet up with one another. And that doesn't sit right with Jacob. Actually, his tail slips between his legs, and he is afraid, the scripture tells us. Verse 3 in chapter 32 says, "Then Jacob sent messengers before him to Esau, his brother, in the land of Seir, the country of Edom, and he commanded them, saying, 'Speak thus to my lord Esau, Thus your servant Jacob says, I have dwelt with Laban and stayed there until now. I have oxen, donkey, flocks, male and female servants, and I have sent to tell my Lord that I may find favor in your sight. Then the messengers returned to Jacob, saying, we came to your brother Esau, and he also is coming to meet you. And by the way, 400 men are with him. Man. So Jacob, verse 7 says, was greatly afraid and distressed. He divided the people that were with him, the flocks and herds and camels into two companies. And he said, if Esau comes to the one company and attacks it, then the other company which is left will escape. Right, so Jacob doesn't waste any time. He's greatly distressed. Now he's making provisions for survival. He's dividing up the group. And in his mind, he's thinking, okay, if Esau attacks one, then the other one can live. But he also remembers what happened 20 years ago at Bethel. Verse 9 says, then Jacob said, O God, my father, O God of my father Abraham, and God of my father Isaac, the Lord who said to me, return to your country and to your family, and I will deal with you. I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies and of all the truth which you have shown your servant, for I crossed over this Jordan with my staff, and now I have become two companies. Verse 11, deliver me, I pray, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, lest he come and attack me and the mother with the children. Verse 12, he says, for you said, Jacob is telling God, for you said, I will surely treat you well and make your descendants as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude. So Jacob is making the provisions for his survival. And he remembers his encounter with God 20 years ago, and he brings it up to the surface, and he says, God, you said this. You said this. And on top of that, he continues in his plan. In verse 20, it tells us that it says, and also say, behold, your servant Jacob is behind us, for he said, I will appease him with the present that goes before me, and afterward I will see his face, perhaps he will accept me. So he starts to divide his stock, his servants, and he has three units. And he says, okay, space yourself. You go first, and you say this to Esau. Then you, second group, you go. And then third group, you go. And you say the same thing. And his plan is that Esau will be embellished with all the presents that Jacob is sending forth. And that his life would be spared when they actually meet, because Esau is just loaded up with all of these presents and would have nothing against his brother, hopefully. Verse 22 of chapter 32 says, and he arose that night and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 sons, and crossed over the ford of Jabbok. He took them, sent them over the brook, and sent over what he had. And verse 24 says, then Jacob was left alone through this whole ordeal that is going on. Jacob is finally alone. And it tells us that a man wrestled with him. And in the scriptures, it's capitalized. The man is not just an ordinary man. He has stature, dignitary status. It says, a man wrestled with him, Jacob, until the breaking of day. Now when he saw that he did not prevail, verse 25, against him, he touched the socket of his hip. This is that man who's wrestling with Jacob. And the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, let me go, for the day breaks. Jacob responds, and he says, but he said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. So he said to him, what is your name? He said, Jacob. And he said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed. Then Jacob asked, saying, tell me your name, I pray. And he said, why is it that you ask about my name? And he blessed him there. So Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved. Just as he crossed over Peniel, the sun rose on him, and he limped on his hip. Therefore, to this day, the children of Israel do not eat the muscle that shrank, which is on the hip socket. So they're wrestling. And the man sees that Jacob will not stop. The phrase doesn't mean that the man saw that he wouldn't be victorious. He saw that Jacob would not stop. So he touched the hip, and still Jacob would not let go. And then the man, which is God in the flesh, sometimes the scholars say Christophany or Theophany, a time where Jesus even came to earth. But the man asked Jacob, like, he didn't not know his name. But what the man was doing, he was asking Jacob, what is your name? Because the name was literal naming back then. If you guys remember, that grabbing of the heel wasn't a cute thing. A cute thing done by a baby. It was full of deceit, full of lying to have someone stumble. That's how he operated all of his life. And the man says, what is your name? And then he says, you are no longer going to be known for that. Instead, your name will be Israel. And he says, for you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed. Later on, the meeting with Esau, happens in Genesis 33. Tells us that Esau ran to meet his brother and embraced him, fell on his neck, and kissed him, and they wept. And Esau's like, what is up with all of this presents you gave me? Here's the application. Two things. Genesis 27, Jacob, the heel catcher, the supplanter, the one causes one to stumble. That's what he was known for. Esau says, is he not rightly named Jacob? For he has supplanted me these two times. He took away my birthright. And now look, he has taken away my blessing. That is what Jacob was known for. His deceitfulness. His sinfulness. And the question for us is, what are you known for? That's a big question. What is your character like? What are you normally bent towards in your life? That's what you are known for. But I tell you this, the God who is faithful is also unconditional. As he's wrestling with Jacob and the blessing, he extends his blessing and he tells him, you are no longer going to be known for this, but now you're going to be known for this. That's unconditional. Jacob did not do anything righteous at all up to this point. And I think we gotta understand that correctly. That his love is unconditional. Coming to church doesn't make you a better Christian. What makes you a better Christian is he laying his son to die for you. You are draped with the blood of righteousness from the son. And the only condition was because of him. Nothing that you did. Isn't that a beautiful thing? God allows us to see who we were. As a Christian, as a child of God, right? That doesn't leave us. Sometimes that brings us down. But the confidence comes with the work of God, period. You know, this morning we were singing The Stand, and talk about a song that messes you up before you're going to proclaim who God is. And it was perfect. Perfect to set me up into that perspective that I am nothing without the work of God. I can't even lift my finger. Can't even open his scripture without God allowing me to. The second part of that, it propels you as a child of God. That confidence that God is the faithful one, that he will not go back on his word. And if you think about it, that is what Jacob was hoping would happen. He said, you said, God. And God was faithful. He changed his name into Israel, which means Prince with God. And I wrote down this, you will no longer be known by what you did. Instead, you will be known by what I have done for you. That is so peaceful, if you think about it. This life, if without Christ, it's about you doing this and you doing that, being known for this and that, even and thinking, I got to bring something to the table. But God tells Jacob and says, you will no longer be known by what you did. Instead, you will be known by what I have done for you. Prince with God, that's what that means. Israel. 2 Corinthians 5:17. I think I had a slide for that. And the NLT says, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. Jacob, this is your new life. You will represent me because you will be the seed. You will be the descendant that I will work in, that all generations would be blessed. See, God is faithful in every situation. Right, this verse right there is not just a happy-go-lucky verse, but it's speaking of the work of God in an individual. Because God is the faithful one in every situation. Hebrews 11, and sometimes it's titled the Hall of Faith. But I think some people, when they preach that, they get it totally wrong. Right, because in the scripture you have God who is the faithful one doing this and that. And at the end of the Bible, you have God who is still the faithful one. And all of a sudden, the Hall of Fame, you've got great men of God. Same God. Same faithful God that works in evil, wicked, undeserving men and women. That is the theme throughout the whole book. The common denominator in anyone who turns to God is God Himself. This is one of my favorite passages in the Bible. I think if you know me, I have like 7 of them. And it's growing. I should say the whole Bible is favorite. I got in trouble once. I came from this angle in this passage where Jacob says, I will not let you go unless you bless me. Why is it favorite, one of my favorites? Because I think when I look at Scripture, these are one instances where God says, okay, here's the interpretation. You don't have to think much. It's not, you don't need a scholar to come alongside of you to understand this. And when you think about salvation, even in the Old Testament, like I mentioned about Hebrews 11, how was this individual, that individual saved when Christ didn't even come yet, but they believed on the word of God. Of the Savior coming. They believed in God. And when Jacob says, I will not let you go unless you bless me, God gives us a diamond right there. And he says, this is salvation. You hang on to me. He puts it right there in the beginning, not even in the Gospels. He says, okay, this is salvation. Don't let go of me. And again, for the believer, this is our confidence. Yeah, we will fail. We will get beat up. We will even bring ourselves to this state of lack of faith. But God does not change his level of faith. And for the believer, right, the speaking truth in love is you hang on. You hang on to him. You dig deeper into the scriptures. You proclaim what he has said. And you never let him go. For the unbeliever, same thing. Same thing. When the scripture says that Jacob was alone, this is not a knock on us believers trying to convert people. Sometimes I sit and it's like, stop. They don't need your thoughts. They don't need your experiences. What they need is to be alone with God. Don't let go. When unbeliever says, yeah, I don't know yet, but I'm still in the trench and hanging on, I said, praise God, that is the best place you need to be. If your conscience was seared, you are lost. But if you're struggling, if you're wrestling with God as an unbeliever, hang on. Because God's time is perfect. You know, a thought came to mind as I was studying. When you're looking at Abraham, and what God called him to do was to go out and go to from his land that he's comfortable with. And right before God blesses Abraham, God meets with him. If you guys remember, it was on the way. It was just like camping. He was just camping on the side of the road, and then God shows up and gives Abraham what he needed to continue on. Think about Jacob. Jacob was at his end, and he made all the provisions that he did. He's left alone. The supplanter, the ankle pick. How does God meet with Jacob? He wrestles with him. What in the world? For the unbeliever, whatever's your greatest hole, God will meet you there. Hang on. Hang on. Don't let go. Lamentations 3, verse 22 says this, through the Lord's mercies we are not consumed because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should hope and wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Amen. Wait on him. Both believer and unbeliever. Because he is faithful. I'm going to ask the melee team to come up. Now pray, but again, just I want to echo what I did last week, Ephesians 1:17. This is the only thing we can do for each other is pray. Paul, again, in Ephesians, he looks down history, sees the mighty works of God and his faithfulness. Then he looks at the church in Ephesus and he says, you are recipients of that mighty hand of God. He says, I'm going to pray for you. Paul says, I mentioned you in my prayers, verse 17, that the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, that would measure of faith would be increased. That the eyes of your understanding, verse 18, being enlightened, that you would know the hope of his calling. And verse 19, you would understand God's exceeding greatness of his power toward us. Power toward us. For the believer, that's your confidence. It's the God who raised you from the dead. For the unbeliever, it's your confidence the one who has the power to raise you from the dead. Heavenly Father, we thank you. I don't know why I cling to this. But thankful, I have a sure foundation to cling to. It's you. Nothing in me can bring you glory and worship. You saw fit what we needed to worship you in spirit and truth. And we praise you for it. I pray for your hand to continue to work mightily in the lives here at Ohana. That we would be your church. We would be your body, your hands, your feet that make your name great. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's rise. Jesus, we sing this song to you. To yourself. Come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs.
on, church.
Come on, my soul.
Come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. Cause you got a lion inside of those bones. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. Cause you got a lion inside of those bones.
Hallelujah, Lord.
Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but nothing else fit for the King, except for a heart singing
the voices.
Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but nothing is fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. You may be seated. Father, we praise you. You are so, so good, Lord. Father, thank you for your word. Father, nothing left fit for a king. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name. What are you known for? What am I known for? Man. I hope that question stays on your puwai, on your heart for the rest of your life. It's a heart check for a Christian. It's a heart check for the soul. Genesis 32:30. Wow. So on. So Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, saying, for I have seen God's face to face, and yet my life has been delivered. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Verse 17 to 21. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God is reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Praise God. Some announcements. Next week, Tuesday, right here, we have our worship, prayer, and praise night from 6 to 7:30 p.m. Check, testing. Call my. Once again, next week, Tuesday, right here, we have our worship, prayer, and praise night. It has been phenomenal. It has been a blessing because God is that blessing. If you have that time, we pray that you would come, that you would join in if you need prayer, or if you just need to be in that place or just glorifying God, come. Welcome. Also, this Saturday, right here at the church, we have our men's breakfast. And that starts at 9. But if you like kukua or if you like help, you can come here at 7:30, 7:45. The man to actually get in touch with is Uncle Art. Uncle Art's always leading that ministry. Don't ask me, ask Uncle Art. No, on a real, ask Uncle Art. He's been that go-to man. God's really put it on his heart to build that platform so us men can get together. I also want to say this. You women, yes, not one of you, but all of you, if you feel that same connection, you want to do something, the church is available. This is, though us Kanis live here, this is not just our hale. This is God's holy first. So if you want to come talk story, if you feel that God is leading, you know, putting that on your heart, and you want to do something, feel free to do that. Okay? You can see Ruby in the back or one of the ladies in the church. So once again, just for clarity, this Saturday at 7:45, 7:30, you can come here, help set up, cook, or do what you do best, and we will have our men's breakfast here. I encourage you to come. Finally, next week is Super Bowl Sunday. And I know, because I know all of your teams, and I know none of your teams is in the Super Bowl. So praise God. Sit down with me and enjoy. Okay? But in saying that, so every year we come on Super Bowl Sunday, not to make much of the Super Bowl, but Super God. But you are encouraged to wear your jerseys. If you don't have a jersey, you have a hat, you do whatever you got to do, and you come. Just don't talk to me if you're not a Steelers fan. Nah. Just playing. But come. It's been a fun journey, you know. We're not, you know, come on. God is bigger than, you know. But to use such a sport to glorify his name. You know, we come in, we crack jokes on guys all the time, especially if you're a 49er fan. But no, it's okay. Yeah. You know what? But come, it's a great time for fellowship. If you don't have a place to go Super Bowl, you can come talk to me after. And I only say that because if you're with the hard-headed kind of guys, then you can come with me. Yeah, if you like go with the kind of mellow kind guys, I'll point you out to a place you can go. But if you like go to the real, you know, the soft kind, like, okay, yeah, touchdown. I don't know if I can help you down, you know what I mean? But, yeah, let's just make much of God next week. Finally, I want to share this with you. and I'm going to release you right after this. Look, whatever you're faced with, whatever you are going through, hang on. Everybody say that with me. So whatever you're going through, what you going to do? What you going to do? To who? I love you. See you folks next week. God bless. Oh, yo.